What do you attribute the turnaround to? Is it just injuries? The boys back here say it's because we changed Mike Rizzo's walk-up song.
Yeah, that's toward the bottom of my list of reasons, the Mike Rizzo walk-up song. But
it did happen on May 22nd.
That's pretty good. I would say, I mean, health is a big reason. I think it's sort of been pushed under the rug. Now that we're seeing them play so well, it's like you kind of don't want to attribute it to something boring like injuries. But when Juan Soto, Anthony Rendon, Ryan Zimmerman, Matt Adams, Trey Turner, list goes on, we're all out in April and May, it was simply just really hard to win baseball games. And that's how you slump into a 19-31 hole. But beyond that, I mean, they're hitting the ball extremely well consistently. The starting pitching has become lights out 1-4, and then the bullpen. Now is not good enough yet. If this team wants to achieve its goals of competing for World Series, it's going to need to add there and get better. But it's become passable, at best. And night to night, you manage as if it's an elimination game with his bullpen, just trying to get through the day and figure out tomorrow. And it's sort of worked to this point. It's playing with fire, but I think all three of those phases are good enough, and then the starting pitching and offense has just been superlative, and it's showing.
So Jesse, big news over the past few days. You wrote about it in the Post that Scott Boras is in town talking with Ted Lerner, the Nats founding principal owner, about an extension for Anthony Rendon. And the most disturbing line in your article refers to the offers to Harper before he left about deferring a lot of the money decades down the road. Word for word, people familiar with Rendon's situation say initial overtures have been similarly structured. Have the Nats not learned that offering deferred money, now in cases it's worked with Scherzer and Strasburg, but guys like Rendon and Harper, they're going to balk at deferred money. What's the latest on that?
Yeah, I think it's twofold. I mean, as you mentioned, it's worked in the past. It's a salary, it's a contract structure that for the Nats has proven to sort of be something that they like to do and think is beneficial for the way they structure their business. But at the same time, though, there are guys, Bryce Harper, one of them, that don't like that sort of situation. But but also at the same time, if the numbers were big enough for Rendon, maybe it would work. Maybe that still could happen if they get into a certain point, or maybe they say we're going to sweeten the deal and get you even higher than you're worth, or you're worth on paper, but we're going to defer money to a certain year. I'm not entirely sure. I mean, of course, we're not in the negotiation room. I wish we were to sort of know the behind the scenes of how this happens. But yeah, I mean, that's what we're hearing right now. And I think to some extent, where there's smoke, there's fire with these things. I mean, once Scott Boras is in Washington, I mean, that certainly signifies that talks are getting more serious. I had someone tell me earlier in the year that when there was that meeting with Mark Lerner and Anthony and Mike Rizzo in the Nationals family room back in April, that sort of not to not pay attention to it or not to not take it seriously, because of course any discussions are significant, but they did tell me that when it gets serious, when it starts to actually heat up, Scott Boras will be there and he will be involved. So Scott lives in, he's on time, so for him to be there and to see him with Ted, someone he's negotiated a lot of deals with over the years, I mean, that was significant. It doesn't mean a deal is going to happen tomorrow or the next day, but I think that means there's traction in a way there wasn't before, because in recent weeks, I've heard that there has not been progress, and there hasn't been a lot of progress since the spring, but I think that was signifying that the Nats and Rendon are moving in the right direction, or at least moving in a direction right now with Scott Boras and Ted meeting.
We talked about it last week. His remarks were just so casual about the whole thing. Like, he was like, if it works out, cool. If it doesn't, no big deal.
Yeah, and I think that's like a mix of Anthony being Anthony to some extent, and also there's some like kernel of truth to that, which is that he's accepted two fates here, which is returning or not. And I think there was a time that his rhetoric surrounding the situation was a bit more firm in staying. A lot of, I want to be a national forever. I want to stay here. I want my agent to work out a deal. And there was a time this spring when he had specifically told Boras to work on a contract with the Nats, work on an extension. And that was a kind of a direct order. But now I think there's a little bit more of a laissez-faire attitude of, if it doesn't work out, I mean, I'm going to be a free agent in less than 4 months. If this thing doesn't go my way with Washington, I've accepted that and I'm okay with that. And that's something that, like, again, is very Anthony. That's sort of how he approaches everything. It's how he approached being an all-star. It's how he'll probably approach, you know, MVP conversations if he ever gets in them. You know, it's kind of like, well, you know, this doesn't really define me. Baseball is baseball, and my life's my life, and I can separate the two. But I don't think it's great. I mean, I think if you're a Nationals fan and you're hoping this guy wants to stay and do everything he can to be in the Nationals uniform, you'd probably rather hear him say, no, I'd be really upset if I didn't come back. You know, there's a lot of different ways that conversation could have gone, and he didn't say, screw you. He didn't say, I'm 1 foot out the door and mm-hmm. see ya. But he did say, you know, I could see a situation where this doesn't work out, and I'm okay with that. Yeah. So, I think there's a lot of interesting elements here to weigh, and we'll, as it heats up, we'll definitely keep probably putting too much stock in these guys' words and trying to analyze them, because that's kind of what we're left with.
And you're seeing how valuable he is in the lineup and the year he's having. Is it your vibe that they get something done before the end of the season, that they do extend him? Or it's my opinion that if he goes to free agency, he's gone. So if they're going to keep him, they got to get it done here in the next couple months. But what's your opinion on that?
If you would have asked me a week ago or even 2 weeks ago, my vibe would have been that he would become a free agent. I think that, again, once Scott Boras comes to Washington and there's face-to-face, a chance, I don't want to say good chance, I hate to put any sort of, you know, quantifiable, chance on it, but I would say that it's trending better than it was. And I think you're right. I think his value has been apparent this year. He's having a career year so far. He's even been a bit banged up and still played through it and put up some crazy numbers and became an all-star. But it's hard to say with these things because, you know, he's gaining leverage by the day. The closer he gets to the open market, the closer he can be to a situation where teams are going to bid on him
right.
and drive up a price. I think that, you know, that lowers the chance of him signing in the short term. You know, in the spring when he was 6 months away, he wasn't sure how he'd play this year. He could have signed without knowing, you know, saying that maybe I get hurt, maybe I have a terrible year, all these things. Then there would have been a higher chance that he signed back before hitting free agency. Now he's playing so well, he knows his value. He knows he's going to be priced as one of the better third basemen in baseball. It just gets harder for me to believe that he'll sign here ahead of time. And you know what will happen? No, it certainly could. And like I said, there is traction toward that. But at the same time, I just think the closer you get, you know, the clock is ticking on his time with the Nationals, a time when only they can negotiate with him. As he nears free agency, I think it just becomes a bigger chance he gets there, because why wouldn't you want to know what teams are going to bid on you, especially when you've clearly earned a lot of money and a big contract?